it's not a knee that I would say that a surgeon should try one time. I think that there are some nuances to it. A cadaver lab is always a great idea, but definitely a surgeon who has done a few hundred of these knees could easily show the aha moments to a new surgeon. And then from them, I think then they would then extrapolate those into their own OR. So there are some little tips and tricks along the way that it is slightly different than a PS knee. And one thing that people say is it finicky? It looks like it's hard to put in. I wouldn't say that it's finicky or hard to put in. I think it's a little bit different in how you feel when you put it in. And if anything, I would actually say that it's actually probably more forgiving than a PS or a CR knee. We have a very wide range of what you can accept actually in a medial pivot knee because it's so stable. So instead of having to have a perfectly balanced medial and lateral compartment, you really have to have a very good balanced medial compartment, which is easily attainable. And then that's what drives the knee and the kinematics throughout. So if we can have that erase those outliers and shoot down the middle, more patients are going to be happy. And I think medial pivot allows us to do that.
With a medial pivot knee, I don't describe a learning curve particularly. What I try to confer to the residents, and I train a lot of residents on the medial pivot knee, is a leap of faith. I call the learning curve a leap of faith. And the leap of faith is don't be concerned about what you perceive as relative looseness in flexion. You can move it back and forth quite a bit. You can draw quite a bit with the patient under anesthesia. The ball and socket will maintain the stability. Trust the geometry. I learned that from David Blaha. Trust the geometry. The stability will be part of the design of the implant. So no concerns about leaving it loose in flexion.
It's a very simple system. If I was to highlight the points during the course of a Evolution knee preparation to be aware of, remove as much bone as you're going to replace. This is not a system where you want to cut too little bone, because putting the knee in tight is probably going to result in a stiff knee replacement. So I remove as much bone as I'm going to replace. That's 10 millimeters for the distal femur. I make sure I put the appropriate amount of posterior slope on the tibia. Under resecting posteriorly will lead to it being quite tight posteriorly, and again can lead to a stiff knee. May even be difficult to get your trials in if you under resect posteriorly. So those are the two main things. Remove the right amount of bone, and ensure you have the right amount of posterior slope. Otherwise, I think you do this knee the same as you would any other knee. I also, one other feature is to make sure you remove the entire cruciate, both anterior and posterior. I think you want to let the polyethylene drive the kinematics, not the cruciates.
I use it in every case, whatever it is, a varus or a valgus or even for revision, because there's no reason why you shouldn't use a medial pivot. I would say the more you use one design, one surgery, the better you get in it. And all through the years, you only can better perform your surgery. And if you go into two systems, it's always different to find the fine tuning of both. And there's no reason why I should have one system for elderly patients and only preserve my medial pivot for the younger ones, or in varus or valgus and make something different. No, if you see what all other companies are doing, they are all moving towards asymmetrical base plates, single radius. So they are all moving towards something like a medial pivot, but they don't want to admit that it's a medial pivot. You see that, it means that they all believe that it works.